Welcome to the Revelation series, part 62. We're getting close to the end. We're in Revelation 20, and there's only 22 chapters. We're going to look at the last third of this chapter, and we'll start with a recap. So the 7 years of the Great Tribulation are over. So if you don't know end times, take a good listen to this. The 7 years of the Great Tribulation are over. There's 21 events of judgment. There's seven seals, seven trumpets, and seven bowls of wrath. Okay? Each event is an attempt to get humans to make a decision for or against God. No more being lukewarm, playing either sides. So halfway through the 7 years tribulation, so 3.5 years in, the Antichrist enters the temple, which is the body of Christ, and declares himself to be God and forces people to worship him. The rapture of the church, of that body of Christ, of the temple, occurs shortly after. So Jesus comes in the clouds and the dead in Christ rise first, and then those who are left go up, all the believers go up to be with Jesus. Following the rapture, many, a great multitude that no one can count, that's chapter 7, will believe and turn to Jesus and will not worship the Antichrist and take his mark, which is that mark of the beast, and as a result will be killed, will be beheaded, in fact. Israel's harbored by God in the wilderness. At the end of the 7 years of tribulation, those who reject God will wage war against him. That's the Battle of Armageddon. And God will respond with the second coming of Jesus, which is Jesus and all the raptured believers will ride in on white horses to eliminate all the unbelievers. The millennial reign then starts. It's a millennial meaning 1,000. God will establish his throne on earth, on Mount Zion in Jerusalem. Satan will be bound and thrown into the abyss for 1,000 years, so he can't tempt anybody. Israel will come out of hiding, the wilderness, so God can fulfill all the promises he gave them in the Old Testament, but couldn't fulfill them due to their relentless rejection of him. But that's God's faithfulness. I will not end this story of this heaven and this earth until I have fulfilled all the promises that I said I was going to do. Raptured believers and the great multitude, so post-rapture converts, will rule and reign with Jesus on Mount Zion over Israel. The end of the millennial reign. 1,000 years. Satan's released and deceives the nations in the four corners of the earth. So Satan deceives the nations of Israel that are furthest from him, furthest from Mount Zion, which will be in the center, it seems. Satan and the deceived people are thrown into the lake of burning sulfur. Okay, and we'll later read that that is actually a lake of burning fire. All right. This gets heavy tonight, so let's pray. Jesus, I just pray that the peace that passes all understanding would guard our hearts and minds in you, Jesus. As we read of our future, and as we read of how you, Jesus, have protected us from eternal devastation, we pray your heart that none should perish, that all would be saved. And we're your hands and feet and mouthpiece. We are the light of the world. We are the ambassadors, so that you can make your appeal to unbelievers through us. So Lord, let this teaching just bring up that gratitude of our salvation, the joy of our salvation, and the urgency to see many come to know you. In your name, Jesus, amen. Revelation chapter 20, verse 11. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and the books were opened. Another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. Anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. As I said, this is a heavy one. Starting at verse 11, then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. So then, it starts with then, this is the next scene. As I mentioned before, chapter 19 at the end, and chapter 20 and 21, all are linear events. So the second coming, the second coming of Jesus, the millennial reign, the thousand years, the judgment of Satan, judgment of the dead, and then when we get to chapter 21, a new heaven, new earth, it starts with then. Okay, so that's our indicator that these are all linear events. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence. This is interesting. Everything spoken into existence in Genesis 1, gone. Except for humanity, both dead and raptured. Okay, gone. And there was no place for them. So think about that. To accent the point, not only are the places, heavens and the earth, gone, the actual physical realm where they resided is gone. The container of those places, which was established before day one, the physical realm, is gone. Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. There would be no lessons, think about it, no lessons to apply from history, no repeating of events, only whether you accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior. That's all that's going to matter in this moment. Not how successful you were, not what a great father you were, or son, or daughter, or mother. It won't matter how many friends you have, how much money you have. Nothing will matter except, did you accept Jesus as Lord and Savior or not? And that story is over. Fled from his presence. Think about that. For now, our holy God can somehow navigate in the sinful, evil realm, but here, his glory will not be shadowed or limited. And this is difficult to put in the words. I had to leave that in the notes. And the full essence of God's holiness will make the fallen, sinful realms flee. Light makes darkness flee. And God's light will be unhindered at this point, and all of the darkness of fallen heavens and earth will be gone. The tension of God's holiness in a sinful world is why he doesn't meet with us out here. With sight, sound, smell, and touch. We want him to, but it's a sinful world. Sin is a rejection of God. Everything out here rejects God. So he wants to meet with us in the spirit. Spirit unto spirit, deep unto deep. Those who worship him, John chapter 4, Jesus said to the woman at the well, those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So you can see the significance of us being the temple of God. God lived in the protected center of the temple in the Old Testament, in the Holy of Holies. He now lives in us, the temple of God. So we protect him from the outside world. Isn't that interesting? Because everything out here is sinful. Anyway, I could go over it again, but I think you get it. The great white throne. Though we saw a throne in heaven, in the throne room, in chapter 4 of Revelation, it was not described as white. So this may indicate that it's a new throne. Okay, to him who was seated on it. We did this back when that line was first, when John first used that line under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit back in chapter 4, when he first saw the one seated on the throne, him who was seated on it. From the first description in Revelation, it is actually chapter 4, not 5, there's still no description of him that John could write that could possibly come close to our human minds getting it. There's nothing created that resembles the Creator. Even his image, humans don't begin to describe him who sits on the throne. Man, I could dive into that, how Adam didn't get it, so he needed a helper. And so Adam and Eve, but Adam and Eve together now are in the image of God, and then collectively everybody. Anyway. Holy. set apart. His ways are higher. His wisdom is greater. He's far above. Love that. Far above. Almighty. Greater is he who is in you, Mr. and Mrs. Temple, than he that's in the world. I love how Aslan, the king of Narnia from C.S. Lewis's, Narnia Chronicles, he says, Aslan, he's not a tame lion. He may come across as approachable, but man, he is not tame. Verse 12, and I saw the dead, great and small. This is interesting. This really jumped out at me. After all the hierarchy of human leadership and government and authority and social status and financial privilege, death is the great equalizer. Dead, great and small, reinforces this point. Great and small, they're all dead. The crowd in front of the throne, the dead. This is all humanity that ever was, starting with Adam. Adam and Eve will be here in this crowd, along with all your Bible characters, you know, or all your Bible. I was dialoguing with somebody, and they said, you know, using the word characters almost makes it seem like they're fictional. All of your Bible heroes, all those believers, they'll all be, and unbelievers, they'll all be in this crowd. So you have all the Gentile believers, which a Gentile is a non-Jew, raptured or resurrected. So all the pre-raptured believers, Old and New Testament, but they're, you know what, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, pre-raptured believers who died, they're actually going to rapture first. So you almost can't, they're all believers from Adam to whenever the rapture is, they're going to pop out of the graves first. And then we who are still alive, all the raptured believers, and then all the post-rapture converts that are killed in the tribulation, that great multitude, the 144,000 witnesses, which would, you know, if our conjecture is right, rightly dividing the word, it looks like they're the babies that were killed back in Herod's day when he was looking for Jesus, who at that point would have been around 2 years old. So Herod killed all the babies 2 years and under. Anyway, I digress, but they're essentially in the group of the dead shall rise first, right? The Jews, the Israelites, who live through the millennial reign and die as believers or unbelievers, right? All unbelievers who died in their unbelief throughout history, this is all in that group that are dead, great and small, dead. At the beginning of the millennial reign, when we saw the great multitude, the post-raptured believers, when they resurrect to join Jesus and all believers throughout history in the raptured church to rule and reign for the 1,000 years, we're given this information about the dead. The rest of the dead did not come to life until the 1,000 years were over. Okay, so all unbelievers are part of this crowd. Oh, but I've been raptured. Yeah, but you're dead. As far as the physical realm goes, you're dead. Yes, you're alive, but you're dead. And we're going to see in a little bit that the Bible deciphers between the first death and the second death. So when it says dead, great and small, it's referring to the first death. They're standing before the throne. Everyone who ever existed throughout the history of the world will now, in this moment, have seen God, some for the very first time. As a result, everyone, great and small, will be a believer. But the time for deciding to follow will be over. The physical realm where the decision is made has just fled from God's presence. And books were opened. This is interesting. Since this is part of the introduction of the dead, these books seem to be the events or stories of their lives. It's a lot of books. Perhaps one book per person? Wow. Billions upon billions upon billions of books. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. This book contains the names of believers in Jesus Christ. Okay? People who have received his sacrifice on the cross for their sins and decided to walk with him in new life. Thus, it's called the Book of Life. And look at the positioning of the introduction of this book. And books were opened. Another book was opened. So though each individual life book will be present there, your book, yes, your name might be in the Book of Life, but you're going to have another book. But that other book supersedes with another book was opened. Thank God. Another book was opened. If just the first set of books, if that enormous amount of books was open, we're all sunk. But another book was open. That's such a powerful thing. We need a t-shirt that says that. Another book was opened. The Book of Life is the ultimate judge and eliminates the guilt and shame of the other books. And in your notes, hallelujah. As the other books represent works, this Book of Life represents faith. Ephesians 2, the Apostle Paul said to the Ephesians, "For it's by grace you've been saved, through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast." So the dead were judged according to what they had done as recorded in the books. It's almost as if the Book of Life is set aside for a moment, while each individual's life is celebrated and rebuked. First of all, it's going to be very embarrassing. I mean, there's going to be moments to celebrate. There's going to be moments where you're just, sorry. And it's going to take a long time. But what else do you have to do? For those who rejected God, think about this. It'll be a tedious reminder of their rejection just before being thrown into the lake of fire for eternity. They're going to hear the good stuff that they did too. But those are like filthy rags to the Lord if you've rejected Jesus. And for those who live for Jesus, this will establish their position in the new story. Wow. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 12 to 15 says, "If anyone builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stone, wood, hay, or straw, for their work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light." So the foundation is Jesus. The preceding verse says that. "It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each person's book." Sorry, work. But, you know, that's actually a good way to put it. That book's going to be written, and you're gonna hear all of the good stuff, the bad stuff, the wasteful stuff, and the precious stuff. "If what has been built," verse 14, "survives, the builder will receive a reward. If it's burned up, the builder will suffer loss, but yet will be saved, even though only as one escaping through the flames." Okay? As recorded, there won't be any testimonies in this one. You won't have a chance to say anything. No testimonies, no excuses given by God. "Well, it was that guy, way back there, about 1,000 people. He made me mad." Well, it doesn't matter. There's nothing you can say. The records will be read in front of you, in front of everybody else, to show what each individual has done. Wow. Verse 13. "The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them." We've seen the deliberate separation between the sea and the land. I find this really fascinating. It's going to come up again in chapter 21. Here, death and Hades seems to be what comes up from the land, from the grave. We haven't concluded the reason that land and sea are separated, but we've considered in past lessons a few times in our 62-part series at this point, the physical division between sea and land, both visually, orally, right? The sound, residences of each not being able to exist outside of the area. The people on the sea or on the land can't live in the sea. Now, with a great difficulty, well, they can't without, they can't. And then vice versa. You put a fish on the dock, it's gonna suffocate. But regardless, this verse reinforces that none will escape the white throne judgment. And each person was judged according to what they had done. This is a word for word repeat of the previous verse. You notice in the text it says that twice. So every deed, make no mistake, will be judged. And each person was judged according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. So death and Hades were released in the fourth seal. Remember, they came out. Well, death was riding the pale horse and Hades was close behind. And they were given power over a fourth of the earth to be killed by sword, famine, plague, and by wild beasts. We noted previously that this duo indicated the action, so death, and the destination, Hades, for those who reject God. Lake of fire, this is so important. It was created for disobedient spirits, fallen angels. Jesus said, then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. God didn't create a place for unbelieving humans because he didn't plan on them rejecting him, right? 2 Peter 3:9, instead, he's patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Unbelieving humans, or those who have rejected Jesus as Savior and Lord, will go to the lake of fire because there's nowhere else for them to go. And I'll say it again, that's devastating to God. The lake of fire is the second death. The first death occurs on earth. We see dead humans rise to be judged, only to go to their second death in the lake of fire. So out of Hades, into the lake of fire. With Hades, by the way. Yeah. So the description of death in Hades, represented by the first death, being thrown into the second death, shows the ultimate finality of the second death. Even the first death dies in the second death. That's dead till you're dead. Verse 15. Anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. This is essentially the sheep and the goats, right? The focus turns back to the book of life, right? After reading the books with both the good and bad displayed for each individual, the good will not overshadow the bad. Only the book of life trumps the other books, the bad in the other books. The faith acceptance of the cross of Jesus, the blood of Jesus, will save a soul, and only them. In permanent ink, there will be no blotting out of the good or bad from your book. In Isaiah 64, all of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. So notice that the book of life didn't eliminate the existence of the other books. Those other books will establish your station in the next story, your position in the next story. You'll be with Jesus. It's going to be great. But you have the chance right now to make it even greater. And I wanted to close with both of these. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And then for us to receive the blessing. Blessed is the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy, and blessed are those who hear it and take to heart what is written, because the time is near.